Hi everyone and welcome back. So let's continue our journey, and here we are writing a restaurant APIs, restaurant search API, restaurant create APIs, restaurant dish APIs. So in the last video we discussed all sort of API definitions, like what all APIs we need. Let's start working on them. So what we will do is we will create all the required DTOs, controllers, services, and so this is how we are creating a DTO. So we decided that we are going to use a search API. We are just doing a baseline, but search actually is going to happen through the Elasticsearch, because we are going to store, index all the data of restaurant and the menus in the Elasticsearch, and so that user can come and directly search in the Elasticsearch. We will be storing a latitude and longitude, and based on that in the proximity we will fetch the list of restaurants which are top rated, favorited, liked by many people. So there will be some rating criteria. For that we are just passing the building this DTO, in which DTO contains page limit, offset, latitude, longitude, basic parameters. So after that we can just add a methods inside a controller, and that controller will call the service. Inside service we will have an interaction with the Elasticsearch, which will just send a query. Because Elasticsearch exposes the REST interface, we will use Elasticsearch nestjs module to query the data to the Elasticsearch index. So we'll have a single index which contains all the data, and here we can also have some pagination enabled. This you can see we are doing a simple search restaurant, and we are using query because we are doing query. These are all our query parameters: path parameter, query parameter, request body, all those things are possible, but this is purely HTTP GET, and these are query parameters which we are passing. Okay, it's a simple search API call, and here it is going to call the service, this dot service dot search. This search we are going to define. Here we will pass just a query. Query means the query DTO, and we will create the search method inside the restaurant service, async search, and we are going to pass the input queries of type this, and then we will do something. I mean, we have now the query parameters. Okay, what is user is looking for, the lat long, locations, GPS coordinates, and the limits, paginations, all the attributes are there. Now we will build this thing. Okay, how we can integrate with Elasticsearch. We can either use some tooling to synchronize the Postgres hooks, Postgres create, update, delete with the Elasticsearch, or we can do this programmatically. Or when you create a restaurant or address, we will populate that in the Elasticsearch. Now create restaurant body, like now we can talk about the how we are creating a restaurant. Restaurant simple post APIs. Okay, we are just writing HTTP post API v1 create restaurant. So this restaurant will create the, so what will be the parameters for this API? Okay, name, description, all the attributes which we have defined inside our entity, like name, description, contact number, owner ID, closes at, opens at, what is a cuisine, what are the options that restaurant is providing. So we are just updating the DTO so that we can just pass this DTO as a request body. And we already have nestjs validation pipe enabled. So whatever we are defining here as a class validator validations, like is defined, all these properties will come into the picture. We will add this latitude and longitude in the entity, and you can also play with these attributes, like which is required, which is nullable, nullable and not nullable. So here we are making nullable and not nullable. Same will be reflected in the database table because we are doing a TypeORM synchronized true. So now lat and long both are not nullable, so you must pass it. Contact number is currently nullable. You can make it nullable false. And you can see all the time these TypeORM queries are running to update the database to match with the entities, database entities. And here pickup options, delivery options, opens at, closes at, and it has some relationship, and the rest is the timestamp, like created at, updated at, and maybe deleted at, but we don't have, I think, deleted at. So it will be just like updated at column, but it will be default null, and it will have some value when you actually purged this restaurant. Like let's say you are creating only restaurant for the test, so you want to mark that restaurant as a delete, then we can do that. So this is, I think we are making null property to the date stamp. So what is happening is it is running this TypeORM synchronize and it checks your entities. If entity has something wrong, obviously it's not going to sit there. It will complain about it and throw an error message. In ideal case, we should write a migrations. Database migrations is the right way to update the productions or non-prod database. So when there is a request, okay, you write a migration, update the database, and then deploy your code. So appropriate column change and all those will happen through the migrations. This is now our create restaurant DTO, which has all these properties. In the create restaurant, you also need to pass lat long name, latitude, longitude, name, description, and all the restaurant properties which we have inside entities. We can also look at it, contact number, and we have delivery options, pickup options, because with the those properties which are not nullable, we must pass it, otherwise this TypeORM will fail our insert operation. It will complain about it. So here, these are the properties we have, right? I just copied it from the entity so that I can manually change it, and I will know, okay, which is required, which is optional, and I can just write it. And here we are using these class validator validations: is optional, is string, is defined, is UUID, is email, is URL. These are really helpful because here we are not using Joy for the payload validations. Here we are using class validator and there is a validation pipe. So if we are not passing the payload correctly based on these definitions we are writing, it will send a bad request. Let's say the banner should have a correct URL. Delivery options is of type string. Then we have pickup options, opens at, closes at. That should be opens at, closes at should be of type date ISO string, but should be stored as a varchar in the database. Now we can just remove it and just update these properties in the DTO. And then we will just go to the controllers, get this payload and send this payload to the service where we are going to create the restaurant. Okay, so here we are going to just populate these all the properties like using API property. Why we do this? So that the Swagger can have all the payload properly, because this all these properties will be reflected in the Swagger. Like what is the description, what is the example value of this, so you can use it to enhance your Swagger docs. You can provide the exact value what you wanted to show or showcase to inside a Swagger document, like email. So you will give an example value of email, how it should look like. The date string, you will give a sample example, okay, date string should be in the TZ format and this is how it looks like. So once you play with the Swagger, you will get what is the default values and you can just randomly do all these operations. So this is our DTO created. We'll go to the controller and then we will write our another method, which is create restaurant, which is going to return us the status code 201 because it's like create operation. And why I'm writing all these annotations, like you can say API operation, API OK response, API description, API internal server error response, API bad request response, because this will expose these annotations in the Swagger docs that this API can throw the bad request, can throw internal server error occurred, can throw forbidden, unauthorized exception, all these exceptions this API can throw. So whoever is the consumer will be aware, okay, these are the possible status code this API can throw. Let's say we are creating a restaurant, you don't have a permission, you don't have a restaurant admin permission, so I will just send forbidden. If you are creating a restaurant, you don't have an authorization token, I will send a 401. If you are passing a payload where the restaurant is already, if you are trying to update a restaurant where the restaurant is inactive, so you can set unprocessable entity exception, right? Unprocessable is, I think, 402. I'm not able to recall. So these all different status code you can send through the APIs. So these are the social links of type JSONB, because social link can be Twitter, LinkedIn, Facebook, all these social links about the restaurant. And here we are going to write our service. Inside service, we are going to create a restaurant. Create restaurant, we are passing two properties. user. So here user context is currently logged in user, the user which is pointing, which is available inside a token, because token means user is already logged in and token contains a user ID, email and the permissions. So this @user is a decorator we have created in the previous videos that is nothing but request.user, which is coming from the auth strategy. We are using auth strategy, that is decoding the authorization header, validating the token, and then extracting the payload from the token and putting that inside a request.user object. So here we also need to have address, right? Because address is required. We need to also create the address inside address entity. So address we are sending inside a create restaurant only. So address can be a nested object, and we can use a validate nested and validate pipe will validate this nested payload, because in the Swagger, in the nestjs APIs, it's not like all these will be the plain attributes. You might have one nested object also which you are sending in the request, and you also wanted to do the class validator validations on the nested object. So I think I'm missing something here. There is something called validate type, validate nested, which we need to pass. So I will check the docs and I will update it in my next video. So this address DTO, we are validating address DTO. Address DTO will have a city, state, name, description, name, street number, state, country, zip code, or these kind of information as a nested object to the restaurant. So when you send it, we should be able to create a restaurant first and then address. So these are like two different operations we are performing. So we will use a TypeORM transactions. TypeORM transactions are the same simple things. You can just create a TypeORM transaction, initialize the transaction, and then do multiple operations and finally commit it. If there is an error, you just do the transaction.rollback, otherwise transaction.commit transaction. It's a similar concept. So here we are using access token guard, and status code we are using is 201 for this access token guard, which is using auth strategy, JWT auth strategy. So it is just decoding the payload, and we should be able to get the payload if the token is correct. Token is not expired, and token, if we are able to decode the token with this secret key, because we have to generate the token from the user service and decode the token inside a restaurant service. So same key should be used to sign it, and same key should be used to verify it. Now we'll just, we are using this address DTO. Now we'll go to our controller. Inside service, I will just use some snippet to create this transaction query runner. And here we need to get the connection that is coming from TypeORM. Private read only connection is of type connection. I need to check the TypeORM docs, how it really works. I don't think it would be a dependency injection. Connections we can directly get from TypeORM. So what we are doing, this.connection.queryrunner. First we are creating a query runner, and query runner.connect, query runner.start transactions and commit transaction. Let's see, do we have this connection in the nestjs TypeORM? Is deprecated. We will just try to fix the code. Query runner we are getting, and here first we will create a restaurant. We'll pass the payload data and currently logged in user and query runner we need to pass, so that it will use this method create restaurant, will use query runner to create the restaurant. Then once we are done with this, we will do await, and in the second line we will create a restaurant address. So once we create a restaurant, because restaurant ID is a foreign key in the restaurant address, so we need to pass the restaurant object while creating the restaurant address. So restaurant ID can be populated in the restaurant address. So create address, create a restaurant query runner, and here we are returning the created restaurant. So this is simple, two methods we have to create: async create restaurant, and then simply what we are doing is query runner.manager.session. save, and in this first argument is the entity which you are trying to save, and the second argument is the payload, and it will just do the insert command through the TypeORM. So we have create restaurant and then create address. These are the two methods, restaurant and create address. What we need to do the next is make this foolproof, so we can have a restaurant post APIs. We should be able to create a restaurant and the restaurant address. It is just using query runner, queryrunner.manager.save. First argument is the entity, and another argument is the payload which you wanted to insert in the database. So we have a restaurant and restaurant address entity. So this is created restaurant, initially is null, and we are just passing these two methods, create restaurant and create address. So now what we will do is, first we will test this if everything is working, and then we will just write another set of APIs after this.